Dobry wieczór. Witajcie na przednaszce w ramce wystawy Jerzego Kowandy Możność a niemożność współpracy. Before I introduce our distinguished guest, Bratislav Bismarck, I would like to invite you to three more events, lectures in the frame of this exhibition. This is actually the last one in this year, but we're going to continue in January with a lecture of Barbara Klimova, as well as a meeting with Zofia Kulik and the screening of a film about Kwie Kulik. And we're going to conclude the exhibition with Pierre Barblon and a dance performance in the frame of the finissage of this exhibition. And tonight I'm absolutely thrilled to welcome Beatrice von Bismarck here in the National Gallery and the lecture entitled Hospitable Collaboration, Collectivity. Beatrice von Bismarck is a professor of art history and visual studies at the Hochschule für Grafik und Buchkunst HGB in Leipzig. And she's also a program director of the gallery at the Academy. Beatrice is a fantastic curator, theorist, writer, you allow me to recite a little bit of the biography of Beatrice, because it is an incredible contribution to what exhibiting, what curating is. Beatrice from Italy, from the end of the 80s actually, participated in forming and defining what the curatorial means. At the beginning of her career, she worked in the Städtisches Kunstinstitut in Frankfurt as a director and the curator of the Department of 20th Century Art. She was curating exhibitions of such distinguished artists as Bruce Nauman, Richard Long, Dan Flavin, or Jürgen Pappenheimer. Between 1993 and 1999, she worked at the University of Lüneburg, another extremely important place for theory of curating. And at the University of Lüneburg, together with Dietmar Stoller, sorry, Dietelhelm Stoller and Ulf Wuggenig, she founded Kunstraum, the University of Lüneburg. Within Kunstraum, the University of Lüneburg, she conducted and curated a number of extremely important exhibitions, such as Legendary Services with Andrea Fraser and Helmut Drexler, that's 94, Öffentlich Privat with Thomas Lohe and Peter Zimmermann, 96. Another extremely important project within this frame, that's René Green, the Digital Import-Export Funk Office. And two more, that's Christian Philipp Müller, the Campus als Kunstwerk, as well as the project in collaboration with Hans-Peter Feldmann, and that's the Interarchiv, 1999-2002. In 2000, you moved to Leipzig, and together with Alexander Koch, Beatrice von Bismarck established a DOCK, project department at the Hochschule für Grafik und Buchkunst. Within this department, Beatrice curated such exhibition as 3 Days Herstellen von Öffentlichkeit, Künstlerische Selbstorganisation with Julie Alt, Be Creative in collaboration with Marion von Osten, as well as the project with David Margreiter that is about Raumvermittlung. She also, at that time, established a series of events and exhibitions about borders and their crossing, or the possibility of crossing of those borders, with many distinguished artists, mainly coming from or belonging to the field of what is being called institutional critique. In 2009, Beatrice von Bismarck established MA program on cultures of the curatorial. Beatrice is the author of many different publications. I'm going to mention only 10 of them, starting from almost the last ones, and these are 2 volumes of the culture of the curatorial, because they are very important, again, in the field of defining what is curatorial and what the curator as a profession may mean, or how it can be defined. So the first volume of Cultures of the Curatorial was edited by Beatrice in collaboration with Jörn Schachaf and Thomas Vesky. And it already maps the field of the curatorial as the field of overlapping and intertwining activities, tasks, and roles. In this volume, Beatrice wrote a text called the exhibition as Collective. The second volume of the Culture of the Curatorial is about timing. It's about processuality and performativity, as well as dramaturgy and choreography. And I guess this volume of Culture of the Curatorial very much corresponds with the practice of Jiří Kovanda and with this exhibition. In the second volume of the Culture of the Curatorial, Beatrice wrote an essay on legendary exhibition from Whitney Museum called Anti-Illusion, Procedures and Materials. And the text is titled Out of Sync or Curatorial Heterochronicity. I'm also proud to say that we once worked together on the volume of Protections. This is not an exhibition, for which Beatrice wrote again another inspiring essay on making exhibitions processing relations. Last but not least, the book which is in print, forthcoming volume, is called Hospitality, Hosting Relations in Exhibitions, in collaboration with Benjamin Meyer Kramer. This is going to be published very soon. And I assume that tonight's talk on hospitable collectivity will be based upon your research conducted in the frame of this book. So once more, welcome Beatrice in the National Gallery, and we are so much looking forward to your talk about what is so precious for not only this exhibition, but the whole year of celebrating the National Gallery's 220th anniversary, which is generosity, collaboration, hospitality, friendship, sharing, and being together. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Adam, not only for the invitation, but for this wonderful introduction, which did not leave out a detail. It was really nice. Thank you. And I'm very happy to be here, particularly really at this occasion in which, quite obviously, please let me know if I'm speaking too low. But you can hear me well now, right? At this wonderful occasion in which kind of the topic of generosity gets intertwined with other topics such as collectivity, such as hospitality, because I think they're so crucial for the work in a museum and in an exhibition space, and the way in which all the participants in such an institution actually relate to one another. By that I just don't mean not only artists, but artists and everybody else, or one artist with other artists and everybody else. So of course I'm very happy that so many people from the museum are here today as well. So let's see whether we can enter into discussion. Something, what I want to do today is, I have experimented with one single piece, which at the beginning might look incredibly dry, but I want to fold out some of the meanings of a piece by Lewis Lawler, which you see there, and I'm in a second going to explain what it is. It's an invitation card, and what I would like to do with it is show that the invitation card at one point can become a site of what I would call a collective hospitality, a hospitable collectivity. And this by actually pointing to the different conditions under which hospitality in its collectiveness can actually take place, and the conditions meaning the ambivalence that might imply as well. And Adam and I were talking when we were going through the museum on the fact that, of course, there are always reciprocal moments, and how do you define them? What you see here is the invitation card to the conclusion of a show in Berlin at the Galerie Neugarim Schneider, which was coming to a conclusion in May 2000, and the title was, and I read out the full title, but if you, yeah, ever so slightly, but you can't go lower, can you? No. But the title reads, "The work shown in this space is a response to the existing conditions and or work previously shown within the space, 3. The idea and the design for that card came from Louis Lawler, and listed are all the artists that had participated in the show, like you see Christa Williams, Henrik Olesen, Lawrence Wiener, and so on. And the idea of the show was that people would participate one after the other, meaning that everybody who came in new would have to react to what was in the space. And you can see, for example, here on the left-hand side, the very first set is Christopher Williams, and Christopher Williams was the initiator of this third installation of the work shown in this space, ... And on the right-hand side, you can see, for example, can you make the right-hand side a little more visible, make it smaller? So you can see that Christopher Williams is still there, and Isaac Genskin put a column in the middle, and it continued like that. And Glenn Daxler did a different thing. They installed a door, and so on. So it was really like one thing after the other entering the space in relation to what there was before. So it was really a way of having to relate to one another. But on the card, what you see as well, maybe you could make that a little bigger again, is indicated the date and the duration of the event. It shows who's hosting the exhibition, in this case the Galerie Neugarim Schneider, you can see it on the bottom left. It shows who was responsible for the photographs and the type design, Jens Zier and Andreas Koch. And of course it gave the title of the exhibition itself, plus all the titles of the exhibits. With this card, Louis Lawler was making use of a form of advertising which is very common in exhibition making. So you want to invite people to actually come to the opening, or in this case, to come to the finissage. However, at the same time, the card is actually referring to the conditions under which this exhibition took place, to the institutionally reframed space, a commercial gallery, to the participants, to the span of time within which the project could be carried out, so there was a beginning and an end, and to the fact that this time span now comes to a conclusion, that it there's a finite indication there, and the whole project has to be considered finished by that time. She provided information that could be expected from such a card, in keeping to the conventions, but not without making visible at the same time that there are institutional, personal, and media requirements in order to put a show up like that. For Lawler's card is not only the designed medium for invitation, for the invitation to this exhibition, but it is itself an exhibition. It's itself an exhibit, sorry, by which I mean it's the final contribution to exactly that space. So when everybody else put something within the space, what she contributed to the exhibition was the invitation card to the finissage, and thus the invitation card not only was a document and a medium, but also an artwork. For that reason, her name appears as the last on the list, which you can see there. So it is this card, and the photograph of this card is by Jens Zier and the type design by Andreas Koch. Even while the exhibition is still running, she offered, so to speak, a retrospective of what has happened before. It's a bit like a, how do you call that with films? The lines after a film, which shows what, who has participated in the film, and which in itself is so collective, who has participated, but you show it while it's still going on, and you show it as the last piece within the show. So it's kind of making not only the card, it turns the card into a hybrid object, but also it turns the exhibition into a hybrid object, because it's on the, it's extending the space into the exhibition card, because suddenly something is happening within the exhibition card that's actually still taking place. So it's a funny warped way, and it's talking about the process by indicating its end. In a way, it's a, one could say, a performative gesture in artistic representation of an event and a participation in the event, all at the same time and intertwined into one another. It pronounces an invitation, so it's a, well, that's what I meant by a performative gesture. I herewith invite you. And by doing so, already performs that act of invitation. So it is performative by being an invitation altogether. And she is reacting, she's documenting what has happened there, but she's a guest. She's not only inviting, but she's a guest of what she invites to as well. She's participating in the event that she publicizes. Artistic produce and artistic act at once, it is essentially defined process oriented, both by the act of invitation and by its inscription into the exhibition process. And I will look at the implication that this dual nature, at least dual, maybe triple nature, of the card has in the following. And I will look at what that means in terms of hospitality, I will look at what that means in terms of representation and what representation means in relation to imaging, to collective and individual imaging, and what that means in relation to modes of participation and her own participation in that set. And I think one of the important things is that Adam has already pointed to the fact that I'm very much interested in the curatorial, but I understand the curatorial as not as a separate sphere from the artistic field, but rather as one that's kind of, again, inseparably interwoven, because there's so many curatorial activities that have not only to do with artistic work, but that adopt artistic strategies and vice versa, artistic strategies that kind of adopt curatorial ones. And it's sometimes not easy, and maybe I would say not necessary, to actually differentiate between the two. But by doing this invitation card, I think one can say that Lola actually took over part of the duties that are usually taken over by a curator. So the invitation card will be something that curators usually prepare and are responsible for and outsource to the relevant people that could then actually materialize, make it happen. And in that case, it also means in her case that she's taken over duties of hosting. And by that I mean actually making these artists, making room for these artists on her card, kind of taking them in as participant and as host at the same time. And the whole question of hosting, I think, and I'll just show you here two examples, has become incredibly prominent within artistic discourse over the last, say, 15 years. I think it has been prominent before, but it has taken on a different relevance again. And I show you on the left-hand side one of the many cooking and meal-presenting situations that Rirkrit Tiravanij did, kind of cooking in museums, offering meals in museums. And on the right-hand side, a Berlin group called Unwetter, which is something like bad weather, almost bordering on a tempest, a group which offers discursive picnics. And they do that all over the world, for example, at the Gwangju Biennial. And the idea that's connected with offering these discursive picnics is a mix of generosity on the one hand. Actually, you offer something for somebody to eat and to feel well. But also the initiation of a discourse, the initiation of an exchange. And thirdly, this exchange on the basis of a non-hierarchical get-together. I think it's always the connecting of hospitality in that case is really generosity, the collectivity and the unhierarchical. So this unhierarchical as an idea of very political, politically meant idea. And just to give you an example of what that meant with Unwetter, Dorothee Albrecht, who's an artist and part of this group Unwetter, was a researcher for the Gwangju Biennial in 2008. And in that role, again, she was swapping roles between being an artist, between a member of a group and a curator at the same time, coming together for that role. And I'm just showing you, just to give you an example of other hospitable situations done within the arts, Christian Philipp Müller's banquet that he did as part of a project in Austria. Hospitality, conviviality, and hosting are becoming qualities demanded in situations occurring in the context of art, and that means not only picnics, but in a broader sense, meals, but you could also call symposia or exhibitions these kinds of hospitable situations. And Plato's Symposium would be the kind of backdrop against which all these criteria could be kind of put one after the other. Curators and artists in these situations feel equally obliged to this practice, integrating their own practice into the economic, political, and social dimensions of a way of working that is giving, generous, and welcoming. And this orientation entails expectations of and requirements for the situations to which one is being invited to, as well as the opportunity to forswear self-interest and reciprocity. And I understand also from the project on generosity that Derrida would be one of the philosophers particularly relevant in that context, that reciprocity is something that has to be negotiated, or say on the other hand, is never quite to be taken out of a situation. So the question would be, what could be the reciprocity in these situations? What do you get when you offer, or what is expected from you when you accept the invitation? And I think this is something that you have to look at in whatever situation it is, which looks so happily uncomplicated in these situations, but usually never is. Initially, the various discourses concerning the act of presentation as a cultural practice are intersected, and by presentation I mean the abstract way of making something public, of showing it to an audience. So initially that act of presentation as a cultural practice are intersected and compressed in the status of lawless invitation card. The focus is on the relationship of artistic work to their presentation. So it's the invitation card as such speaks of becoming public, speaks of addressing an audience and wanting that audience to pay attention. Out of the nature of that relationship, which justifies the work as an aesthetic object, but is no less conflict-ridden for that reason, arise questions of dependencies and a whole latitude of actions that come with presentation. And I'm talking here about the continuous duality of artworks themselves. Artworks always show themselves and show something else. So with a card like that, the card shows something else, which is, it points to the exhibition, it points to the artist's work and all that on the conditions that I've already mentioned, but it shows itself as an exhibit. So in that sense, the iconic difference, as one might call it in this case, comes to the fore in a very intense way. By that, I want to point to a very specific iconic difference in relation to the curatorial. And by that I mean the zone that opens up between a work showing itself and a work showing something else. Because you're very much tempted in the curatorial field to think that's something you outsource. Somebody else is responsible, somebody else will do the showing of my work, somebody else will be responsible for the way it's put up. And my argument, and in that respect, people talk, for example, about the curator as a middleman, as the person who mediates between an artwork and its audience. And I would rather like to turn that into a more spatial metaphor and into a zone in which the way in which presentation takes place is negotiated, and the showing itself and showing something else is always part of the same sphere, because artworks are not thinkable without this being connected. So why should showing something else suddenly be outsourced to curator? Why should it not be part of the whole way of arts being in the world? And in that respect, there's always a curatorial aspect to an artwork, and also one might say, but one doesn't have to say it, an artistic work maybe to curatorial practice. But I think all I'm trying to hard at it, that it should not be separated from another. It should be looked at as kind of imminently intertwined. So then the question would be, at what point do we actually look at the presentational bit of art as something that has or can at all be outsourced and given to somebody else? And under what conditions should that be possible? From here, you might say, isn't presentation necessary to art to become art at all? I mean, what that in the social theory of art, there's always the argument that it has to be seen to become art. It has to become public to become art. Otherwise, we can't talk about it. If it is not seen, how can we actually address it? And since art is so much a matter of consensus, that at least more than one person agrees that this is art, so it's a social construction, so it has to be presented. And on the other hand, the philosophical interpretation would be that the specificity of art is that it shows something other than that which it is. So there is always a double meaning. I just called it the deictic difference, but you could also, or the iconic difference, but you could also just kind of go back to this, that art is more than a normal object because it shows something beyond its own being in the world. But that both of those attitudes point to the fact that we're talking about an aspect of showing, and in with this showing is always an aspect of presentational, of presentationality in it. So coming back to Louis Lauer's invitation card, it's as a documentary publication, it's an object for the exhibition, but it's also commenting as an exhibit. So it's part of the show, but it's in this part, it's very much in the tradition of institutional critique, at least commenting or taking the context into account in which she's actually presenting. And the mode of self-presentation inscribed in and characteristic of the work of art, as the philosophers would have it, also alludes to the fact that the act of presentation used in exhibitions necessarily raises the question of, and I just hinted at that, it raises the question where or what is or can be involved in the presentation in addition to the work of art and in what form. To put it in another way, if works of art are presentations and indeed presentations of a particular kind, so more than a normal object, which are therefore only realized in the perception of a social other, then what part of the presentation is a component of the work of art and what is an additional supporting aid? And that brings us to a next step. That means art, to become art, has to become public. And what does art do to become public if it has to rely on itself? And what Louise Lawler does, she uses a medium of publicity to become public itself, but to make others public as well. And that has, it breaks the seeming separability of the goals of aesthetic and attention economy. I would call that attention economy because I think attention economy is the economy most important for the arts in terms of acquiring capital. I'm using here the Bourdieu term of capital. You can acquire financial or economic capital, but for the arts that is of course incredibly important. But the most important is to acquire symbolic capital because that can be transferred into financial or economic capital. And attention economy kind of addresses as much the symbolic as the financial capital or the way of acquiring it. And this way of addressing an audience and addressing the means in which artists have addressed audiences or in which art institutions address audiences. So this means of publicity have been something that in Lawler's work frequently appear. And they do so in invitation cards, they do so in little objects that she produces for donors, dinners for the MoMA, for example, that has been very important. She produces posters. She has different kinds of ways of producing stationery for certain, for example, for the Documenta 7. She designed pages for art magazines and created advertising material for events and initiatives. So this whole idea of consciously addressing an audience as part of her own art belongs to her, it's an imminent part of her practice. That harks back to a tradition that we know since the 1960s. Mm. And I'm showing you here on the bottom left, this is a page from Art Forum. And on the bottom left, you see an advertisement that does nothing more than advertise that this is an advertisement. And this is for Douglas Hübler's contribution to a show at Zitzigelaub. And Zitzigelaub was one of the most important, how shall we say, maybe entrepreneurs in the late 60s and early 70s who really redefined the function of a gallery and a gallerist, the function of a mediator, the function of art, because he was very much trying to irritate the existing ways in which publicity for art was materialized by doing a gallery from his own drawing room, by installing exhibitions in a kind of very movable, flexible paper format. And his artists, or the artists that he worked with were, for example, Douglas Huber, but there were really four that were in the core group, which is Douglas Hübler, Lawrence Wiener, Joseph Kossuth, and Robert Barry. And, for example, their contribution to a show consisted in self-interviews. And these interviews were all there was in the exhibition, which was rather radical at the time. But they really kind of addressed the fact that publicity is the necessity for artists in order to do their work. And the way that these four artists, as conceptual, as representatives of conceptual art in America at the time, brought what Zitzigelaub called primary information, which is the conceptual information, and secondary information, which is the materialization of that concept, inseparably together. And that's a bit what we find with the Lola piece. So it's really in that kind of tradition. But it's also in another, I'm always going the wrong way. Thank you. It's also in another tradition. And this is one that's a little less conceptual or really ranging, coming from a different background. You see on the left-hand side a very early piece by Dan Flavin, I mean, who's familiar with this fluorescent light tubes wouldn't think that this is a very early work, Mira, Mira, and that's the Spanish for look at me, look at me. And on the right-hand side, a rather early-ish Bruce Nauman, pay attention, please. And both works very much, they're young artists' work relating to this need of the attention, what I call the attention economy, of the receiving the attention of an audience. And they're ruder works by Nauman I don't know whether you know, pay attention, Motherfuckers, or their ruder works by Vito Acconci, in which he's insulting the audience in order to get their attention. So in the late 60s and early 70s, there's a lot about this desperateness of, on the one hand, trying to insist on a certain kind of autonomy and the realization that there's no such thing as an independence from an audience, so you might as well kind of redefine the relation to that that audience. And this also is the case with two artists, both again American, Martha Rosler on the left-hand side and Linda Bengtus on the right-hand side, who developed postcards that would actually get to their audience. Maybe at that point not necessarily explicitly defined as artworks, but using the invitation card as or the magazine advertisement as a mode of already talking with that about the situation of women artists at the time. So on the right hand side, do female artists actually have to get undressed in order to get attention on the right hand side, and on the left hand side, Martha Rosler showing herself in conventional women's settings, but announcing an exhibition that is, of course, then looks very, very different. So in this case, showing is becoming a seduction on one's own behalf. So as if an artwork or an artist always is in this strange situation of seducing the audience in order to pay attention to his or her work. And there are other artists, I just showed you the two female artists, or women artists. You also find that again with Acconci, but you find it with Bob Morris or with other people who actually use this advertisement as a mode of announcing your presence as an artist. Lola's card displays the act of inviting in its generous giving dimension, as well as in the dimension that interweaves attention and recognition as it is employed in commercial contexts, as well as such as branding and marketing tourism. Lola takes up the contradictory demands on art between autonomy and commodity form, causes them to confront each other on the card, sort of at the same time, and thus takes up the basic ideas that had inspired the exhibition, eluding economic appropriation by means of processual and relational means. Yeah. Even if this orientation can no longer be convincingly brought to bear in a commercial gallery in the year 2000, it bears within it the goal of the original project to which it can be traced back. So when it says three at the end, this show is a da-da-da-da-da, part three. Part one, the one that it refers to, is this. And this is a show that was initiated by Peter Nadin, Christopher D'Arcangelo, and Peter Lawson in 1978. And again, it was a show in which one artist added something to the already existing situation in which other artists had already added something. And the beginning was that the three initiating artists really worked as suppliers and constructors of walls for other artists and apartments and so on. So having suddenly a situation in which they could act freely, they said, okay, let's do something. We supply the walls and we supply the setting, and now we invite people into that site in order to react to one another and to the site. And in that exhibition, people were, for example, Louis Lola was part of it, but Daniel Buren, Sean Scully, Lon Sweeney, Peter Fenn, Dan Graham. So you can see The setup of the 2000 exhibition really related to the earlier one, trying to invite as many people as possible to the show, which actually came to an end because of the suicide of Christopher D'Arcangelo in May 79. But you can see here that the idea of process was already trying to materialize on the announcement cards that they sent out at the time, meaning the you see on the left-hand side an early stage in which they left a lot of space for what was to be to come later on, and on the right-hand side you see some of the fill-ins already that took place, and then the very last one again was Louis Lola. And you can see here that it was really meant on as something to undergo, to avoid the commercial mechanisms that in the late 1970s were really coming back very vehemently. It was the beginning of the early AIDS, beginning of an art market that at the time was, you know, going highway, and this attempt to do something that's process-oriented and ephemeral and can thus not be marketed was a very strong idea at the time. And the way that the artists of the 2000 show related to that also indicated the process and never-ending aspect of it, like Lawrence Wiener called his own work and so on. Henrik Olesen and Christopher Williams dedicated their work to Bastian Ada and Christopher D'Arcangelo as if it was a continual memento mori on memory. It was after Peter Fend, as if there's always a time that, you know, you can, there's always a time after Peter Fend, which was one other part. And the idea of equalness. Everybody who's in the show had the same saying, what they wanted to put in it. Nobody could actually say, no, I don't want that in because it makes my work look shady or something. It was really meant as a kind of very unhierarchical space. However, in Berlin, this whole process orientation is clouded by Lawless' contribution in as much she removes the idealized pretension of an open equal coming together that can be achieved through hospitality. And she does so by, once the attack on or the negotiation of this position of the host, who is actually hosting what or whom at this time. And you could say the Galerie Neuger Riemschneider was hosting the whole exhibition. But you could also say that Christopher Williams, who actually initiated the project again and referred to the older exhibition, was participant in the old exhibition, hosted it as the one who invited the artist. But you could also say that Louis Lola turned into a host through the fact that she was hosting all these artists on her card, which was part of the exhibition. So in that respect, it's an interesting way of, you know, of an age-long negotiation between artists and curators, who actually has the last word in saying what all the exhibition is about. And secondly, I think what she did with her piece is that she turned something that was meant to be sequential, one after the other, and this in a continuous way, in an open way. It could happen again and again with a different and a new addition, into a simultaneous presentation, as if it was a normal exhibition, which only existed with the artist continuously next to one another, and she made it end. So hers was a position of a very different status from the other artists, because she was the one who indicated the end, and she was the only one who had all of them together in her piece. So I think my argument in the end is that this is a way of transformation, of an exhibition into an exhibit, of an exhibit into a space for negotiation about what it actually means to be hosting and to show. In that respect, sometimes that is the same, sometimes it's not the same. But I think what it also does is to point at the nature of exhibitions as products, and in that respect as potentially also commodity-like forms. And I think to keep that in mind with exhibitions, I find at least productive. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Patrice, for, please sit, please. Thank you for this beautiful lecture and for introducing the work of Louis Lawler and for basing our argument on the work of Louis Lawler, which is for me very precious, and I was sentimental because sometime, I guess 2001, I was invited to curate a project in Casino Luxembourg, which basically meant to invite an artist. And I invited Louis Lawler. And Louis Lawler invited other artists who were invited by other curators. So there was a series
Very
of
nice.
Invitations mm-hmm. That in this context even become more conceptual as an entire sort of framing or embracing of an exhibition making as actually the pleasure of making, because this is what I appreciate the most as the message I got, not the only one, but the major one from mm-hmm. What you were talking to us about. And I also think that one can make a parallel to what we did or what Yishi did here within this project, because it's very much based upon an invitation, since us as an institution invited Yishi to make an exhibition, and we all agreed that there will be yet another invitation followed mm-hmm. Because Yishi invited the group of 15 artists to work with him on this project that discusses what collaboration its possibility or impossibility is.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I'm sure there will be a discussion and many questions asked to the notion of hospitality and art practice as and curating and possibly a zone in between that is at its essence based upon a service. And if I may ask the first question, coming back to one of your earlier projects, the one I mentioned in the introduction with Helmut Draxler mm-hmm. and Andrea Fraser, it was called Services. Mm-hmm. And as much Louis Lawler's practice, which is very much a gesture towards towards an art system, curating, making exhibitions, and we can say documenting them, the arrangement of pictures, very famous set of photographs. These are, we can say, at the very trivializing installation shows,
mm-hmm.
the
mm-hmm.
photographs of not the work of others, but of the exhibitions
mm-hmm.
Made by the curators mm-hmm. in collaboration with the artists. So this is a form of the service as well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everything which you mentioned with her doing merchandise for exhibitions or for galas at MoMA or whatever, fundraising dinners and everything, this belongs to the whole service area. That's exactly what Andrea
mm-hmm.
was also
mm-hmm.
earlier thematizing by making fake guiding tours or making a welcoming speech, which was one of the most groundbreaking performances
mm-hmm.
of hers. Can you talk a little bit about this, the kind of context of a service, or the what you here, I guess, defined as a hospitality, or doing things together, or doing something for others, or within the kind of community, as a service, as a, because service is also a kind of way of giving away something towards someone.
Yeah, that's a very nice question, because it raises so many aspects of say an institutional reflexivity on the one hand, and a catering to the needs of exhibition of institutions on the other hand, that maybe have dictated the 90s very much. And by that I mean this project services, in that there were made differences between offering services to the museum, offering services to an audience, and offering services to the co-artists or to the artist scene, the artistic scene. And all these three are really differentiated from one another, because it can be that offering a service to the artistic community actually is in conflict with the museum, or offering service to the museum is in conflict with the audience, or something like that. So you really have to look very carefully what it means. However, what I think with Louise Lawler is interesting is that she uses the service as a medium to critical reflection on the conditions in which she's offering it. And when I showed you Rekrit Tiravanija, then the second generation in the 1990s were much more kind of trying to offer different conditions and not so much a critique of the existing ones.
The relational aspect.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So we would have that, the relational aspect, much more in it. Whereas with Louise Lawler, who is older than the second generation of institution critique, so she's really between the first and the second generation. She's really the 80s generation rather than the 90s. But it has always been her aim, as you said, to use something that might look like this is an installation documentation, as you said, but it's not. It's never neutral, because it's always a comment. It's always showing something about the conditions in that rule the art field, be it economically, be it socially, be it aesthetically. So this kind of, you know, fits in very well. And it, again, it looks like a service that she's offering, meaning I do publicize the event of the exhibition, but she does it in a very, I think, interesting and very subtle way, ever so slightly, as a sidestep to the conventions of the invitation card.
People or events or artworks from the history and give them space, give them relations and so on. But how would you maybe help me understand this or comment on this. Thank you.
No, I think as it actually relates to any presentational situation, only that maybe the what I would call the factors or the elements that participate in it differ in their nature and in their agency. By that I mean in a situation, in a curatorial situation, I think you have all the participants at the table, and by that I mean the artists and the curators, but I also mean the exhibits and the display objects and the site and the discourses surrounding it. So you have an amalgamation of very different elements within that situation. And then and of course you have the audiences and as a kind of and you have all the different people that play a role in the art field. Yeah, so that's what I'm the whole personnel of the art field, and they relate in the and if you talk about hospitality, I think then they relate to one another under conditions of hospitality. They and that can mean that can start with a very basic thing of inclusion and exclusion, and inclusion and exclusion can mean the public or different kinds of public, but can of course also mean different kinds of work and artists and different forms of work or different ways in which you can appear or not appear. So I think inclusion and exclusion is one of the maybe. It's important, but then it goes. It has to do with what do you offer, and how? What is on offer? Are we talking about resources? Are we talking about space or time, or are we talking about material presence? So, what does anybody offer to whom or what? And I think then it becomes a kind of very intricate web of hospitable relations, which you can, I think there's no way around it. It's more a way of becoming more conscious of the way that you design them, that you actually fill them. And there's no way that you can be all inclusive. So there might be other forms and reasons for exercising in an exclusion. So, but you have to be conscious about it.
I'm curious to hear from you. You've been writing about this a lot, and this is a maybe very banal question, but I think it may be it's worth to ask again the question. You mentioned the zones, that mm-hmm. you want to use the term zones of negotiation. We, within our large audience here, we have artists who have an experience as curators. We have curators who have an experience as artists. We also have those working in the institution and that are interested in modes of getting attention in terms mm-hmm. of building the audience. Mm-hmm. Could you help us to understand this process of negotiation that, according to you, is a successful form of relationship, as exhibition making is a process of making relations between an artist and a curator?
I'm not sure that I can, but I am very interested in these continuous processes. But maybe let me answer to that from a different point of view. I run this course on which has the broader sense to do with the curatorial and curatorial studies, and it's situated in an art academy. And the Art Academy voiced the wish that some of the participants of the curatorial May perhaps would curate an exhibition of one of the classes. And now these participants come out of our teaching and are extremely sensitive towards not stepping on anybody's toes, of not taking too much power into their hands, but rather kind of wanting to negotiate what can actually be seen and how it can be seen and why it should be seen and what the conditions are and so on. Whereas the group of artists, of students, like the participants of the course, said, okay, now this is my work, you're the curators, and do something. So these two groups stared at one another and said, okay, these are different cultures of addressing the curatorial. I'm only mentioning that example because of course you can make at a very early stage the decision, I don't want to have anything to do with the presentation of my work, other than I tell you how I would like it to look, and you are responsible for making this possible as best as you can. But there, on the other hand, there's so many other ways of negotiating in that sphere between not public and public, between not being seen and suddenly being seen. And I think I mean that there's no good and no bad way. It's just, it's something that is, that's not natural, but it has to be thought about in which way that relationship should be. And has become necessary because over the course of the 19th century, and particularly when the art field expanded so much in the 60s, the professions began to be incredibly differentiated. So you had a very clear idea of this is a museum curator, this is a freelance curator since the late 60s, you had a very clear idea of this is a museum of contemporary art, and this is a museum of natural history, or this is an exhibition space without a collection, and this is an exhibition with this collection, which again makes a bit of... So we have started to think about institutions, roles, tasks, positions, along kind of conventions that have become stronger and stronger over the course of the last 40 years.
But yes.
And I would like to break them up again.
But I love this term, culture of curating, because it doesn't have this sort of educational imperative. It's like culture of, you know, behaving, culture of eating, you know, how to eat properly, you know, like that belongs to our upbringing, education, and so on. You know, it's a culture of curating. It's like how to sort of behave while doing things or something.
Oh, that's nice.
On the one hand, you know, we do have our backgrounds, educational backgrounds, right? And the artists, they graduate academy, and curators, they're either graduated whatever art history or other, you know, this is very unclear mm-hmm. what can one graduate in order to mm-hmm. become a curator. So we can sort of define those zones, right, as a kind of field of expertise. So it can be made clear, correct me if I'm wrong, if we really want to say like who is who in this game. You know, you did, 20 years ago, you wrote a book called Games, Fights, Collaborations, Games, Fights.
Yes, it's still going on. First of all, cultures of the curatorial is a plural. So it's not meant like the culture of eating properly, which I love. I think it's very nice that you mentioned that. But the idea with the cultures of the curatorial is particularly that we do not assume one culture, but we assume that there are many, and then that they are defined regionally, or that they are defined by gender, or that they are defined by class, or by media, or by discipline, whatever. But we have to do with cultures of the curatorial that do have very different forms of appearance in very different contexts. And I think you're totally right. I think we have acquired an expertise in different fields and different professions. But what I'm saying is that these fields and professions follow certain conventions. And they do so because it has become very practical to do so, because the art field has become so big and so enlarged and so diversified. I think it has become very practical. However, in the 60s, the artists were the first to run against those conventions, to oppose them by stepping into areas that were usually reserved for everybody else, like...
Übergrenzung.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And what I said with Grenzbespielung, I think it was exactly this idea of stepping onto the field of work of curators, of writers, particularly of curators and writers and critics at the time, to take on tasks that were usually reserved for them. And Daniel Biren is such a wonderful example, but you could use many, many, many others, and that have become the normal thing now, but in the 60s it was rather new. But vice versa, you could say that also, and there again, Harald Seemann is such an iconic figure. There are others who, from the field of the curatorial, actually stepped into the field of the artists and took some of the tasks, but also some of the reputational bits from art into the realm of the curatorial. And I'm not saying either one thing is good or bad. I'm saying I think it's necessary to ask yourself continuously why you delimitate your sphere of movement in a certain way. And you have to do that from an artistic point of view as well as from a curatorial point of view, or from a critical or from critiques point of view. I think it allows for a redefinition of what you can do within the art field. And not only that, I think it allows for the on a symbolic level for the definition of practice within the art field in relation to society. Because it means that a lot of the existing conditions can still be negotiated, if not changed. And I think that's something that I would always try to make strong in this kind of negotiation business.
Thank you. Do you agree?
Sorry?
Did you have an exhibition where it was a disaster, this negotiation, where did you want to call people that you can use negotiating?
I think it can be a disaster, quite easily. because what it means is that you have to enter the space of this, or the curatorial situation with the, yourself, very relational attitude, so that you have to find out your position in relation to all the others continuously. And there are projects for which this is not useful at all. And it's not practical. It's not it doesn't really help for anything. But there are others where I think it's actually very nice, because you don't know from the beginning how fruitful this process might actually become, because maybe something else that neither of the participants anticipated will become visible. And there's this very nice text by, I don't know whether you know it, by Irit Rogov, How to Dress for an Exhibition. It has become, again, one of these iconic texts. And it's very nice because she says, you come, for example, she takes the exhibition Male Body, I think it was Male Body, in the Whitney in the beginning of the 90s. And instead of encountering an audience being kind of mesmerized by the images that we're seeing, she encountered an audience that was looking at itself, because they came together for an exhibition in which they wanted to see the male body, but the male bodies in the audience were dressed up to be seen as well. So you can't foresee that. And I think these kinds of participatory situations are not only related to the public or to the audiences, but to every thing and body in the exhibition.
Mm. Yeah, hi. In continuation to what you say, I wanted to ask if during your practice, your curatorial practice, you have considered or thought difference between how an artist is considering public and how the curatorial a curator considers the public. Also, in which kind of way the audience considers itself a public, if this is something that it's easily registered in terms of, as far as I understand, like the there are different artists considering the public in a different way. At the same time, curators are most of the times are obliged to consider the public, not necessarily work curatorially for the public. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? Like, do you think that there are differences? And if that it's an interesting, let's say, point that an artist and curator can basically negotiate what is public.
I think there are differences, but I would say they have a lot to do with conventions that the art field has agreed upon. By that I mean that usually I think curators are supposed to have the public more, to look more towards the public, because they are meant to address an audience and they're meant to be responsible to have an audience at all. And that stemming from many different sides, meaning the museum has to legitimize itself as a public institution, usually, well, if it's public, then as a public institution, because the money comes from the public, so it has to give something back. And the curator is the guarantee for this to happen. On the other hand, the curator is kind of he's or she is related to the artist and has to make their work public. So I think in the convention, it would be the curator who's much more interested in addressing and kind of raising an audience in the proper way. However, what I try to show in the paper is that actually artists do have the same interest in it, and they may have to make a decision how much they want to be responsible for it. And some artists, like Louise Lawler, takes a lot of responsibility, and you could say that goes all through the history back to somebody like Gustave Courbet, who does his own show in front of the Exposition Universelle. But it's a decision to make. And if you say, no, I don't want to be responsible, I want to have a say in it, but I would really like that somebody else does it for me, that's also okay. But the interest should really be very similar, only that maybe the means are different. And if I come back to Pierre Bourdieu, then what he's written is that it's an unwritten rule within the art field that art and artists are never interested in money or attention, but they're only interested in their work. So it's the idea of art to be kind of not so much oriented towards this kind of exterior, so that a curator would be the door to open towards the public. But that's a very sociological point of view.
Yeah, but I was just wondering that maybe in the works of artists like Laurence Wiener or like Louis Laure, there is an attempt of building the public as not an assumed material that is already exists, and building the public is also an in my opinion, like the use of invitation or the use of materials that they attract attention not only for an already public that would, in terms of like an institution, will be already something that somehow is inscribed within an institution practice, but with an artist practice, the building of the public is part of the practice itself. To build the public as part of the public, not something separate, or bringing the public in, or trying to find the public, but building it. So that's why I'm very interested of if it's something that you have been thought of as a.
If I understand your question right, then I would always think of a cultural situation as already thinking about the existence of an audience, whether they're present or not. They're there. I mean, otherwise, the recognition as art wouldn't work. For art to become recognized as art needs this kind of being public and needs the audience. However, if I understand you right, then of course the question is what kind of public and how big, how differentiated, how often, what's the nature of that public? And I think when I talked about relations, then I think this is exactly what I'm talking about, this how to define the specific relation between, say, an artwork or, say, an exhibition and the audience. What kind of strategies can you develop to define that relation in a meaningful way? And that includes the generation of public, but it's much more about what you want there to happen between those components.
So continuing the topic of the audience and moving back to Louis Laure's invitation, this project was made for an exhibition in the private gallery, Neugrim Schneider. And I'm just wondering whether it would be possible or if there's no difference if we were dealing with the public institution, like this one, state one. Yeah? That's different audience, different agenda, another size, you know, the whole apparatus and everything. And then the second kind of related question is, coming back to your background, you, at the very beginning, worked for a museum in Frankfurt, but then you were connected always to small places, kind of sophisticated contexts, university run, or basically a school campuses or something, where there is another audience, another agenda, And I'm just, you know, struggling every day within a monster like this one. I just need answers to what is possible, you know, to what extent we can suck off this, you know, publicity department, PR here, yeah? Because that's the part of it. And that's what we kind of go through every day in order to make this audience, which is wonderful, and we love all of you and each single person in this room, but of course, we would prefer to have a more numerous audience. We would prefer to raise this kind of curiosity of people that constitute the audience to this extent that we wouldn't be embarrassed by having too many empty seats in a room or being kind of tortured by the fact that nobody is going to come to your lecture. Yeah? So to what extent we can afford an experiment of this nature, to what extent this is like self-devouring game that is fabulous on a conceptual level, and to what extent it really creates this community, but the community can be a symbolic one, of course. However, again, coming back to numbers, we are, as a state-run institution, counted by numbers. And depending upon those numbers, we, our subsidies, whatever, are being given or not. And this is a measure, unfortunately, of our success. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So we are not independent, and we are, we just, we can't afford this, maybe. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm just not courageous enough. Maybe I just shouldn't care. But we are here sitting, and we really go through this. This institution is, in a way, in transformation. And this institution is discussing the intensity of what needs to be done in this huge, large scale, five collections, six venues, institution. Yeah? And we have projects like IGIS where this set of events is large one, because we think that they really correspond with what this exhibition is about and what his practice is about. Yeah, and how to maneuver with this, how to make it work, because unfortunately I think it doesn't. But maybe I'm wrong. And sorry. It's more to the audience rather than but it's the easiness of working within kind of less constrained institutional systems, like I can imagine at the university campus department, you have this more sophisticated audience that speak another language, that you communicate differently, and it's part of the curriculum and whatever. But I think all those public institutions, they really go through a tremendous crisis. That will definitely end tragically. That's my pessimistic look at it. But I might be, you know, I've been living for 2 years and a half in Czech Republic, and the pessimism becomes my second skin.
Yeah, I think there's so much debate about the future of the museum. That's true. And you're right, I worked in small places and I did so on purpose. there are many things. Luz Lawler did this particularly because it was a commercial gallery. And I think the card worked in that commercial context. It was extremely site-specific. She would have done it differently in MoMA or in Whitney or something where the economic pressure is so blatantly in your face.
They are private too, in a way, right? They have the trustees and they...
Yes, but there she did a different project. I mean, she did a project that was related to exactly that, to the fact that they were incredibly dependent on private money, and she did something for that. She did a napkin for the fundraising dinner. And the napkin itself was talking about, so the site-specific, I think, is I think, working in very different contexts. Secondly, that I think is true for my work too. So when I left the museum and went back to university and we founded the Kunstraum, it was exactly for that purpose of bringing theoretical thinking and a cultural practice back together, an artistic practice back together again, which now again has become extremely normal. But at that time, the education was not meant to work like that, nor was the practice meant to work like that. So the issues that we've talked about today, I think, were really important issues already then, and we tried to address them by questioning. With projects were about services, they were about publicness of art, they were about digitalization, they were about archiving aspects, and so on. So it was always trying to, and that's what I tried to go on with when I went to Leipzig. So the spaces that I worked with then, for me, were like tools to bring people together with a question, and then see whether, with all the different participants that were not any students, we could perhaps move into something that we hadn't seen before and that hadn't been there before. But I think it's a wonderful situation to be in. But let's perhaps not make it too beautiful, because talking about site specificity, these spaces never fit into educational sites. They're not wanted. If they are visible, then the university wants to put it at its, like a decorative coin here. But that would mean if it's, once it has become decorative, it has to do different work. And they don't want it because it really runs counter to the structures that an education institution has. It has different rhythms, it has different payments, it has different personnel, it has different structures of honorarium, whatever. It does not fit in. So what we try to do with these spaces is make them a counter space within the university system. And that brings me maybe to the third point. I think what you do here, from the wonderful dense crash course that I got today, makes me think, or makes me believe, that it's always possible to address or to feed into different needs of an institution, meaning numbers as well as experimental spaces. And when I say a counter space, I think then you have these experimental counter slots in your activities here, and they're not the ones that probably draw the enormous amount of the crowds, but they're the ones for maybe a different kind of audience, but you're playing into larger audiences by different exhibitions, like Mucha is obviously finding a lot of attention, Rousseau, I mean, all these, there are other exhibitions that do that. And I think the way in which museums still could work is on this kind of diversity of programming, and I think that's what's happening here very much. And that means that one choreal situation could actually counteract another one or comment on another one indirectly, and making kind of that visible, what's happening here. And I think the Generosity Project sounds very much like it raised interesting questions in that respect. Is that an answer to you?
Yes, thank you. It helps a lot. No, but this is like also, again, I just would like to make it so specific too and go back to Yiji, because maybe I take it wrong or too simplistic. What I always understood in case of Louise Lawler is a certain art of camouflage. Mm-hmm. That she like becomes part of this apparatus, yes? Like this, you talked about the publicity and so on. And it's like kind of almost like Jiří Govanda, who for 17 years was working here in the National Gallery, you know, in the storage, and he was kind of one of those employees of mm-hmm. This institution. He, you know, was getting, he was on the payroll here. Mm-hmm. And maybe did this kind of crossover within a sort of institutional practice, of the practice that is not artistic, but that this can possibly create a certain zone where identities merge and a kind of new quality is being born.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think potentially that's exactly it. And walking through your exhibition today, I think it raised it. There were so many interesting irritations, like the entrance to the archive, Adam was pointing out, and the way that you guide people and you leave them, and the way that the architecture frames it and opens it up again, and the way that one doesn't quite know how kind of authorship is distributed, so who's involved in what, in which way. Since I only looked at it, I wouldn't have known whether there were processes beforehand or not, or whether this was a reaction between two artists to one another, or whether it actually was the end of a long process, or maybe it was just a minute of interfering. I think it raised so many issues that we take for granted, that walls are there to do this and that within a museum's within a museum. History is there to do this and that. Documentation is a clear-cut thing that has nothing to do with the actual art, but is separate from it. I mean, it raised so many questions as to the definitions that we're used to, and that are, I think, irritated in a productive way. That I thought that it is a kind of exhibitionary intervention. That's how I took it, and I think that the collaboration very much
Sorry.
Are you okay? Anyway, I think in that I'm not misunderstanding the show, but I think that's what it did to me in the context of the exhibition. Shall we say politics of the Hull House, because it has a very special place within the set of exhibitions that take place here. It does something specific.
I think what was an important part of this show is was a book, because before even those installations were materialized, there was a time of thinking and developing those collaborations on the basis of drawings or exchange of images, making collages, mm-hmm. Putting things together, trying to develop a certain common language as well as methodology, mm-hmm. That led towards the exhibition. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we put on this process also because we thought that we're going to publish the book for the opening, which means that we wouldn't have any images of the actual mm-hmm. installation. But then we changed our mind, and now we have a kind of complete with collages mm-hmm. as well as installation shots.
That's
so
lovely.
Mm-hmm.
So you can actually see the steps of the process.
Mm.
Mm.
I don't want to. I'm sorry.
I
Okay, so I have just one comment. I think for me it's really important that you have this space here, even though you sort of complain that there are not enough people, and that's probably true, but also you have a lot of events here. But this is exactly it, that you don't feel like there's a differentiation between the, that big differentiation between like a lecture and audience. So quite often some of the actions happen here like the non-hierarchical way, like we had a workshop here, stuff like that. And you also cooperate with the schools, and so, and this kind of like bringing in some different I don't want to say communities, but you know, maybe I don't know how to find another word for that, but this, I think, it's really important for the institution, because it didn't happen here before. And it's not that you just sort of giving the space to someone to show their products, but you're actually working with someone, and you trust someone to do something here. That's a very different thing than what was here before. It just, I think, takes a lot of time to have an impact on you know, the whole scene. And what I think is extremely important, at least for the, from the contemporary point of view, is that the scene has to feel that it's their institution. That's important.
Thank you so much. I think actually this was a beautiful conclusion.
A lovely conclusion, absolutely.
Thank you so much for articulating this. Beatrice, thank you so much for coming to Prague, and please come back. You are always more than welcome with our arms open, because we are as hospitable as you are, and we all have to be. So thank you again, and please come back tomorrow. There is an atelier with you.
There's a
there is a tour with Edith and Iji. And I think this is the last event of this year. And the next year, Barbara Klimova will be here, Pierre Balblanc, who contributed to your timing volume, and also Zofia Kulik, amazing Polish artist who had been working in the collective Kwie Kulik for many years. And we will be showing an incredible film, very recent film, showing this relationship, or its impossibility, or how cruel the relationship between partners working together can be. And Sofia will be here too, and we're going to be talking about this. This is an important moment, because actually the very first exhibition of Iji took place in 76 in Warsaw, and at that occasion he met Sofia Kulik. So I'm happy that she will be here with us in January. So thank you again, and white Merry Christmas.